O Sons and Daughters, number 420, verses 1, 2, and 3.
Yeah. of your people that you have made your own. Increase, we pray, the grace that you have bestowed, that all may grasp and rightly understand in what fount they have been washed, by whose spirit they have been reborn, by whose blood they have been redeemed. Your Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. The community of believers was of one heart and mind, and no one claimed that any of his possessions was his own, but they had everything in common. With great power, the apostles bore witness to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great favor was accorded them all. There was no needy person among them, for those who owned property or houses would sell them, bring the proceeds of the sale, and put them at the feet of the apostles. And they were distributed to each according to need. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
On the evening of that first day of the week, when the doors were locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in their midst and said to them, "Peace be with you." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them. And he said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. Whose sins you forgive, they are forgiven them. Whose sins you retain, they are retained." Now Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples said to him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger into the nail marks, put my hand into his side, I will not believe." Now a week later, his disciples were again inside, and Thomas was with them. Jesus came, although the doors were locked, and stood in their midst and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hand. Bring your hand and put it in my side. Do not be unbelieving, but believe." But Thomas answered and said to him, "My Lord and my God." So Jesus said to him, "Have you come to believe because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and have believed." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples that are not written in this book. But these are written that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that through this belief you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Happy Easter.
Happy Easter.
No, it isn't, it's still Easter. You know, when we hear the Gospel of John, I always get excited because we start looking for all these simple signs and numbers. But there's no numbers in here today. Not much of a sign, but there is a word that ought to catch our attention. If you don't know Hebrew or Greek, so we probably don't catch it. But Thomas, Didymus, you know, Didymus. Who in the world, what is this? Why does John seemingly take the same story that the other evangelists had where Jesus came in the room and, you know, he ate fish and showed that he was really physically present, and now show us in a different context? Probably because John is the last of the evangelists who wrote, even though he's the only one that was really with Jesus. And so it's kind of like waiting until the end. He tries to fill in some of the gaps because some Christians are already dying. James has already been killed. You know, it's like, it's not looking good. But what do I need to do to help shore up, you know, God's people? And that's what we see today. Didymus, you and I can identify with Thomas. You know, do we still have doubts? Do we wonder sometimes, is Jesus really the Lord? Is he really God? And so we have so many signs and wonders that were certainly real. But as we look at it today, I'd like you to think about our continued exploration of the whole idea that, you know, Jesus was in the garden. You know, we went to the garden last week, the old gospel song, "Walk in the Garden Alone." But there's another gospel song that says, "Just a closer walk with thee." It's amazing how some of these old songs can have so much to say in so few words. But we looked at last week in terms of the reality that Adam and Eve were created in what was called the garden, God's garden. And when they sinned, when they went against God, they were escorted from the garden by the angel. Now, at the end of the Gospels, we find Jesus is in the Garden of Gethsemane. It's the Garden of Olives, the Garden of Life. And we think then of him being tried and killed. What happens? He is buried in a garden. Point to saying the garden. So it's all about, you know, leaving the garden, now you and I as God's people being brought back into the garden through the death and resurrection of Christ. And as we look at that reality, today we're called to say, all right, how do we get there? Well, Jesus, I am the way, the truth, and the life. How do we get there? Well, how do we follow Jesus? And that's what we're doing. Pope Francis, and one of the reasons he seems to confuse, I think, so many people, is because he keeps trying to work from this mindset that you and I are on this journey together. It's not me and Jesus. No, it's you and I. We are a church. We are a people of God. That's why the first reading would describe how, you know, those who were in the members of the body of Christ lack nothing. In other words, you keep an eye open for one another's real needs. And what that describes is this journey together. We walk with the Lord. And as we walk along with the Lord, what do we hear? What do we find? What kind of Jesus is it? What kind of Jesus is it? That's important to understand to begin with. What kind of Jesus did you hear described in the gospel today? Was it one who said, "Hey, Thomas, what's the matter with you? Why were you here last week?" No. Thomas probably didn't even go to that upper room right away, knowing, as it said, they were in fear that the Romans or the Jews would be looking for the other apostles and said, "I'm out of here." You know, but then after they seemed to have got through that day safely, he finally comes and joins them. But whatever his reason was, Jesus doesn't say anything about that. He just seemed to want to confirm what Thomas's need is. We're looking at Peter there. Does he say anything to Peter when he comes back? "Peter, why did you do that to me?" No. He warned him ahead of time that he would betray him 3 times. But does he ever say, "Peter, you're going to be damned"? No. He says, "Peter, once you have been tested, I pray that you will help the others. You will walk with the others. You will lift them up." We say all the apostles, and then he was arrested. All of them left him. And yet, even with all of that, we never get a word of condemnation or saying, "Any of you are really going to suffer," except for Judas, who said it would be better had never been born. But looking at these apostles who are gathered here, we find a Lord who comes in their midst now and is willing to continue to walk with them. Now, as we go on that walk, you have to think sometimes of our own walks. When you go walking with your spouse or with a friend, it's about being close, isn't it? Adam walked in the garden with the Lord, with God, so he can talk about the different animals, all kinds of things on his heart. You and I are called to walk with the Lord. We are called to walk with one another. And so when we walk with one another, does it ever happen that that somebody stumbles or falls? And what do? When that happens, probably laugh, right? No. But your spouse unites. But you don't say, "You dumb fuss, why'd you do that?" What do? We reach out after we quit laughing and try to help them up, don't we? And that's what we're doing. We're called to help one another keep on the journey, get on our feet. And how do we do that? How do we do that? Jesus gives us today the primary tool that he wanted the church to have. And what is that? The forgiveness of sin. Today's Divine Mercy Sunday. And immediately after the blessing, you're all going to say, "We're going to Divine Mercy." We're going to say, it's not going to take long. Now, we're saying maybe a half hour, but we're going to say only a few minutes. It's not the bishop's one, we're going to do it ourselves. So we're looking at Divine Mercy Sunday, where our Lord's supposed to be appearing to a nun and said, he wants us to pray the Divine Mercy. So he gave us the prayer even that we're going to use. But looking at that, Jesus has the power to forgive, doesn't he? Remember when he healed the paralytic? People around were saying, "Hey, how can you do that? Only God can forgive sin." What do you think Jesus did? I bet he kind of smiled at him. I bet he kind of looked at him. "Guess what? I am God. So I can forgive him." You get a chance to watch The Chosen. It's got some wonderful insight into human behavior. The second episode is starting now, so you can pick it up. But anyway, Jesus has the power to forgive sins, doesn't he? And if he has that power, does he have the power to share that gift with others? Of course he does. And that's what we hear today. Jesus says, after they receive the Holy Spirit, "Whose sins you forgive, they are forgiven them. Your sins you retain, they are retained." So that this power is now available through all the apostles, through all the priests, through all those throughout the world. Matter of fact, 2 years ago, the Pope called a number of priests from all kinds of countries just to come together and reflect on and make them ambassadors of mercy, to remind them that the primary purpose of confession is not to see how bad somebody is, but to be as a doctor, a healer, to say, "Hey, guess what? God's mercy is unbelievable. God is so ready to forgive anything and everything if there's any sense of sorrow at all." So if God offers that gift to us through the church, you and I do well then to recognize it. Okay, we're walking with the Lord. And as we're walking with him, we stumble. And when we stumble, he's there to pick us up. And he says, get up. Let's keep walking. And I do forgive you. So let's go on this journey together, recognizing it's not just Jesus, but it is Jesus also through you and I who are called to help one another get back on our feet. Let's keep that in mind as we celebrate this wonderful gift today. And if we haven't used the sacrament for a while, I'd certainly encourage you. Think about how, in the very near future, we can make use of the sacrament of reconciliation.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things are made. For us sin and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit, he was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake, he was crucified and overturned by Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is the Lord and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and life to come.
Confidence. Now let's bring our prayers to the Father as we recognize our dependence on him for all good things.
In rising from the dead, Christ destroyed death and restored life. Let us cry out to him, saying, Lord Jesus, you live forever. Hear our prayer.
Lord Jesus, you live forever. Hear our prayer.
You are the stone rejected by the builders, which became the chief cornerstone. Make us living stones in the temple of your church. Lord Jesus,
you live forever. Hear our prayer.
You are the faithful and true witness, the firstborn from the dead. Make your church bear constant witness to yourself.
Lord Jesus, you live forever. Hear our prayer.
You alone are the bridegroom of the church, born from your wounded side. Make us reveal to the world the love of bridegroom and bride.
Lord Jesus, you live forever. Hear our prayer.
You are the first and the last. You were dead and are alive. Keep those who have been baptized faithful until death, that they may receive the crown of victory.
Lord Jesus, you live forever. Hear our prayer.
Light and lamp of God's holy city, shine on our friends who have died, that they may reign forever.
Lord Jesus, you live forever. Hear our prayer.
Father, we give you praise and thanks today. You've shown us your love, your power, your kindness. Grant now these prayers we bring in Jesus' name, as he is glory forever and ever.
Amen.
Let us sing number 789, Sing with All the Saints in Glory, number 789.
Jesus.
renewed by confession of your name and by baptism, they may attain unending happiness through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Amen.
Lift up your heart. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord, but on this day, above all, to laud you yet more gloriously, when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. For he is the true Lamb, who has taken away the sins of the world. By dying, he has destroyed our death, by rising, restored our life. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exult in your praise, and even the heavenly powers, with the angelic host, sing together the unending hymn of your glory, as they acclaim. Supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing. He gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you, for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith. Gracious to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned here before you. in your compassion, merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, to all who are pleased in you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever.
Thank you.
we pray, Almighty God, that our reception of this Paschal sacrament may have a continuing effect in our mind and heart through Christ our Lord. Adopt that prayer and request it to you. And Jesus asked that we pray at 3 o'clock every day. That's every day, not once a week or once a month. But that's every day. In the Bible, it's called the hour of prayer where the apostles went back to the synagogue to pray with them. Immediately. And then tonight, we do have again the study of the Mass and the Bible. We have some sharing the snacks at 5:30. That at 6 o'clock. That was really a wonderful study. You want to come and join us? I talked about snacks this morning back to Mass. There are some sweets out there in the hall and in the kitchen. Some coffee's made, so if you want to stay and chat a little while, I encourage you to do so. Really good apple fritters. We don't take them all. Paul with a fritter like one of them. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Mass is finished. Go now in the peace of Christ. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
You inspired Jesus with the source of life just for our souls, and the ocean of mercy opened up for the whole world. A fount of light, unfathomable divine mercy, envelop the whole world and empty yourself out upon us. O blood and water which gush forth from the heart of Jesus, as a fount of mercy to us, I trust in you. O blood and water which gush out from the heart of Jesus, as a fount of mercy to us, I trust in you. O blood and water which gush forth from the heart of Jesus, as a fount of mercy for us, I trust in you. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Eternal Father, I offer you the body and blood, soul and divinity of your dearly beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, in atonement for our sins and those of the whole world. For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
Eternal Father, I offer you the body and blood, soul and divinity of your dearly beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, in atonement for our sins and those of the whole world. For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
Have mercy on us and on the whole world.
Eternal Father, I offer you the body and blood, soul and divinity.
beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, and atone for our sins and those of the whole world. For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
Eternal Father, I offer you the body and blood, soul and divinity of your dearly beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, in atonement for our sins
and those of the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
Eternal Father, I offer you the body and blood, soul and divinity of your dearly beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, in atonement for our sins and those of the whole world. For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
For the sake of his sorrowful passion,
have mercy on us and on the whole world.
Holy God,
Holy Mighty One,
Holy Immortal One,
have mercy on us and on the whole world. Holy God, Holy Mighty One, Holy Immortal One, have mercy on us and on the whole world. Holy God, Holy Mighty One, Holy Immortal One, have mercy on us and on the whole world.
Jesus, I trust in you. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.